their upward space-time Wiener-Hopf factor. Please.
Okay, so thank you very much, Alex, for this invitation. I'm very pleased to participate to this probably this seminar at King's. Okay, so I'm going to talk about those distributions which are determined by the space-time Wiener-Hopf factor. Actually, the aim of this talk is to talk about the conjecture, to present the conjecture, which is satisfied by big, large classes of distributions, but we still haven't been able to prove the whole conjecture anyway. So I will present this conjecture through examples and try to justify why we raise this conjecture. Conjecture actually that any probability distribution is determined by its space-time Wiener-Hopf factor. And so, first, let me introduce what Wiener-Hopf factorization is. So, this talk concerns any probability distribution in U on the real line. So, it's very very general, and because Wiener-Hopf factorization usually is understood as a factorization for infinitely divisible random measures, like in the setting of Levy processes, but it's not. It can be much more general than this. So let me introduce these types. So the first type of a random walk whose step distribution is mu. So mu, this distribution I want to study. And tau plus is the entrance of this random walk in the positive half net. Tau minus is the entrance the first time this random walk enters to the negative half lines. And this the Wiener-Hopf factorization says more or less that the distribution mu is entirely determined by the law of this random walk taken at time t minus and this random walk taken at time t plus, those two random variables are seen separately. Okay, so that's exactly actually what says the Wiener-Hopf factorization. So I'm going to write down here those definitions. So mu is a probability measure and Sn, okay, is a random walk with step distribution mu, and then tau plus is the first passage time by this random walk into the positive half line, okay, and then tau minus is the first passage time of this random walk in the negative half line. Okay, so those are definitions we will keep in mind all over the talk, right? And okay, so but actually the Wiener-Hopf factorization says a little bit more than this. It takes account of both bivariate distributions, so tau minus s tau minus and tau plus s tau plus. Okay, so that's okay. So this is a picture actually. So I draw a picture in order to illustrate what the time tau plus and s tau plus are. So okay. Tau plus, so this random walk, they can say that it is the path of the random walk, and then the random walk first visits the negative half line, and then tau plus is the first passage time after time one of this random walk in the positive half line, and then I'm looking at the value of this random walk at this time, right? Okay, so what does Wiener-Hopf factorization say to us? Okay, it concerns the factorization actually of the characteristic function of the measure mu. Okay, in terms of the characteristic function of both variables, both bivariate variables, which are tau minus s tau minus and tau plus s tau plus. So, key minus is, I'm going to call the characteristic function of this bivariate times we can take this function at real values less than one. So it's perfectly defined. Anyway, okay, so this factorization says that 1 minus s times phi of t, well, phi of t is the characteristic function of mu, can be written in according to this as this product which involves chi t plus and chi plus. Okay. So in order to paraphrase William Feller, so the remarkable feature of this layer of factorization is that it represents an arbitrary characteristic function phi termed of two distributions, one which is distributed on the negative half line and the other one which is distributed on the positive half line. Okay, so when Feller says this, he only means the distribution of S tau plus and the distribution of S tau minus. Okay, so actually when you forget about the variable S, then it's true that phi can be, well, is entirely characterized by the characteristic function of the random walk at time tau plus and the random walk at time tau minus. So you do not need the variable S. Right? So that's the way it's written now. Okay, so if you take, for instance, S equals 1, then this characteristic function is written in this according to this formula. Okay, so that's what William Feller meant actually. But we may wonder, what about the information carried by the first variable, by S actually. Okay, so there is an additional information in this identity, and what about this additional information? We don't need it in order to characterize the characteristic measure of mu. So what about it? And in particular, can we say that this characteristic function is characterized, well, this low, okay, the low mu, is characterized by chi plus. Okay, so we raise this conjecture that I'm going to justify this talk. So any probability distribution support is not included in the negative half line, obviously. And is determined by the characteristic function of the bivariate unknown variable. So I'm going to define it here so that we have it in mind. So that's S to the tau plus times EIT S tau plus. Okay. So this obviously this characterizes the law of the couple tau plus and S tau plus. So, but is it enough to describe the whole distribution mu? Right, so the aim of this talk is to justify this conjecture and to present a couple of classes, big classes actually, of probability distribution, for which it is satisfied, this conjecture is satisfied. Actually, the problem has been raised by Vincent Vigon in the early 2000s in his PhD thesis, where he dealt actually with the case of Levy processes. Okay, he raised this question, this conjecture for Levy processes, and actually for in the setting of infinitely divisible distributions. So, and we'll see in the end of this talk that actually the value of factorization for infinitely divisible distributions is not exactly the same. So it's strongly related, obviously, it's not exactly the same, and the question is relevant. So this question actually is more general. If this question can be solved, then the problem is solved for infinitely divisible distributions. Right. Okay, so now in the proof of this result, there is a proof of this value of factorization William Feller's book, the second volume, towards the end. And in this book, Feller uses this identity, actually, this identity which involves the chi plus. Okay, so for S with values strictly less than
1, so this guy was easy to see that this guy was strictly less than 1 in modulus, so that this is this logarithm is perfectly well defined. And this logarithm can be expanded according to this formula, which means that actually this the data of this convolution product of the measure mu by itself on the positive real line is equivalent to the data of this chi factor for any S and T. Okay. So which justify this, which explain that the conjecture C that I just presented is equivalent to this conjecture, so which is that any distribution mu on R, whose support is not included in R minus, is entirely determined by the convolution products mu, mu star n restricted to the positive half, which means that it's equivalent to say that random walk Sn is entirely determined by the data of the law of Sn for any n bigger than 1. That's exactly the same as saying this. So this assumption, I think everybody understood this, this assumption actually. Obviously, if the measure is concentrated in R minus, then we don't see anything in R plus, and it's impossible to determine this measure. But whenever there is a single atom, or whenever there is a set, a Borel set, which is a positive measure in R plus, then we think that it's enough to determine all the measure. All these iterations are enough to determine the measure. Okay. So let me focus. So this is not really important for the sequel of the reminder of the talk, but we just focus on an equivalent form of this conjecture, which follows from fluctuation theory. If we consider the past maximum process of the random walk, okay, so that the S bar n is the maximum of the random walk up to type n, then, thanks to free state identity, we are able to relate the law of S bar n to the law of S plus n. That's what we call free state identity, which is an identity, a famous identity in fluctuation theory. And this identity allows us to state in another way conjecture C or conjecture C prime. So any distribution mu of R is entirely determined by the knowledge of the law of S bar n. Okay, not only the I don't talk about the processes. Just the law of S bar n for any n. Okay. Obviously, if I knew the law of the process, it's very easy to see that the law of the process is enough to determine mu. Right. So we have been able to prove that this conjecture is satisfied in the following situations. First, when mu admits positive exponential moments, or positive moments, but exponential moments, but which is bigger than 1. So I'm going to explain why in a few minutes. And also, we consider the case where mu has a density. I will show also that, we can always assume that mu has a density. It's without any loss of generality in this conjecture. And then if mu has a density, then and if this density is completely monotone in R plus, well, it's actually slightly more than completely monotonicity in R plus, then this conjecture is also satisfied. Okay, and also when the density is analytic in R plus, slightly more again than analyticity in R plus. Also we consider the density. Consider the case where mu is infinitely divisible and admit an extension. We know mu only on R plus, but mu admit an extension on R which is infinitely divisible, and its Levy measure satisfies some conditions. Then in this case, again, conjecture C when I say conjecture C is satisfied for all these classes of distribution, I mean that, well, these distributions satisfy some conditions, and these conditions obviously can be determined from the data of calculus. Otherwise, it wouldn't mean anything, it wouldn't make no sense. So, these conditions can be determined only from calculus or from the data of the convolution products F star n for any n on R. Okay. Right, so that's what I just said. So we can actually, in conjecture C, we can assume that the measure mu has a density on R. It's without any loss of generality, and it's quite easy to see. I can justify it here right now. And then you take another random walk, S prime n, which is independent from Sn, and whose step distribution, well, that's actually a renewal process. Step distribution has a density with respect to the Lebesgue measure. And this step is positive distribution. Okay, so this random walk is known, we know its distribution, any distribution anyway, and we assume that S and S prime are independent. Obviously, the difference S minus S prime is again a random walk, and the step distribution is computable, so the step distribution has density, and this density is given by this convolution product, as everybody knows. Okay? So now assume that we know the law of this new random walk, and also we know the convolution iterations of mu restricted to on R. Okay, we know this stuff. Then we know the convolution iterations of G on R, restricted to R. So that's very easy to see. We know this. Since we know this now, then by taking the Fourier transform of this, then we know the Fourier transform of G, we know the Fourier transform of F. Then if the Fourier transform of F does not diminish, we can find a distribution like this, then we know the Fourier transform of F. So it means that we can, so if conjecture C is satisfied, then we can assume that mu is absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure. Right? So now let me pass to the exponential, what we call the exponential class. So I say what we call the exponential class. Maybe think that I forget to mention that this work has been done. It was written in the first slide. It's been done in common with Ron Doney from Manchester University. Sorry about this. Anyway, so what we call the exponential class, right? So it's the class of distribution which admits a positive exponential moment, which is finite, okay? And this exponential moment is strictly bigger than one, okay? Under this condition, which can be determined from the data of the iterations of mu restricted to R plus, obviously. Then, under this condition, conjecture C holds for mu. Okay, so that means that we only need to know either the characteristic exponent chi plus or Sn plus in R plus in order to characterize it. Okay, in this case. So, that was the case which was investigated by Lassantigou in the early 2000. For Levy processes, actually. I talked about this work a couple of minutes ago, and that's how we were. This work actually inspired our work. Right, so let me just give a proof of this fact, which is very easy to see. But Vincent-Vigo's proof is quite different, actually. In the setting of Levy processes, so he gets an analytical proof which consists in extending the characteristic exponent of the lambda processes of the whole complex plan, and with some argument in complex analysis got the result. Well, this we are pretty happy with this proof, which is quite short. So everything comes from this lemma, actually. Okay, so this is very general. So SN is a random walk with step distribution U. Any distribution, and I recall that, so I define phi to be this Laplace transform taken at minus lambda, actually. So it's not exactly what we call the Laplace transform usually. Then, for any positive lambda, the Laplace transform of Sn plus raised to the power 1 over n converges towards this. So that's a very simple trick, actually, it's a simple remark. But everything comes down now. So since this result is true, then you can deduce, you can derive directly this theorem, obviously, because, we only know the law of Sn plus. So that's the only thing we know. And this converges towards this quantity. So if there is a lambda such that this quantity is bigger than 1 and finite, then since phi is a continuous function, there will be an interval on which this happens. This, the function is bigger than 1, strictly bigger than 1 and finite. And knowing the Laplace transform of a probability distribution on a small interval is enough to know the function, any small interval. Which means that the distribution of the mu is determined in this case. So it is very easy to see. So now this identity is abused. Bounded by 2. So if phi is strictly bigger than 1, then this term converges towards 1, which explains the second part. That's just this, not more. Then now, what about the case where phi is less than 1? Then either mu is 0, which we can determine, actually, in this case, there's nothing to do, or phi is a strictly convex function, in this case, phi is less than 1, and phi is definitely a strictly convex function. And moreover, the derivative at 0 of phi is negative, which means that the random walk Sn drifts towards minus infinity. Then, in particular, this term here, this term which is this in the expression previous slide, so this term tends to 1. Since this term tends to 1, this expression which was on the previous slide converges to 1 over alpha. That's it. And then, according to the decomposition of this term I presented in the previous slide, we get the result again in the case where phi is less than 1. So that's it. So, under this assumption, then we have a distribution which is included in the class of distributions for which conjecture C holds. So there is also the class of completely monotone functions. What is a sure that everybody here knows what a completely monotone function is, but anyway, just recall it briefly. So a function f, which is defined on the positive half line, is completely monotone if its derivatives are positive and negative alternatively. And then, according to a famous result by Bernstein, this happens if and only if f is actually the Laplace transform of a measure on the positive. So, in particular, there is a positive measure, the positive half line, such that f of t can be written as this Laplace transform at t. Examples are a
power functions of the exponential, and so you can have an exponential minus alpha t to the beta, where beta is, I don't know, bigger than 1/2, I don't know. There are many examples. In particular, okay, so that's very, the distribution in this case is very smooth, as you can guess. In particular, it's analytic on the order, open half line. Anyway, if so now I recall that we can always assume that mu is absolutely continuous. So we assume this absolute continuity of mu because it's required in almost this theorem. Then in this case, if f is completely monotone, and if moreover, so that's why I said in the beginning of this talk that f is completely monotone, well, slightly more than this. If moreover the support of this measure nu, contains a sequence an such that this series is infinite, then in this case, the measure nu can be characterized by the, not only by the iteration, not only by the iteration of nu n star n, for all n, but only by the two first, by f and f star f on orbits. So that's enough to characterize the measure mu entirely. So that's very interesting. So it's a very poor information, apparently a very poor information compared to the distribution itself, but we can characterize this. Also, so this is not very restrictive, actually, this condition. We'll see why this condition is required, actually. I'm going to give now an idea of the proof of this result. Well, it's not a proof, actually. So the crucial of observation is this trivial lemma, which is just easy computation. So I define f bar to be f of minus s. Okay. So then this kind of convolution between f density and f bar, okay, is given in this way. So what is the interest of this lemma, of this stuff, is that now what is on the left, on the right side of this equality is known. Okay. Because I said I know that the convolution product as a function by itself. So I know this term, okay, for any t, for any positive t. So. And also I know the function itself for any positive t. So I know this term. Okay. So I know for any positive t, I know the right hand side of this equality. And also here, I know the only thing I don't know is f bar, which I want to determine. I know this term because I know f on the positive half. So if the operator, this operator, can characterize the function f bar, then I will be able to determine the function f bar because I know it. Okay. So now I need to find conditions on the function f, so that okay, conditions on the function f, so that the operator integral from 0 to infinity of f of t plus s g of s ds characterizes the function g belonging to m1 of f plus, for instance, whenever this is finite. Necessarily finite, but anyway. So, does this operator characterize the function g in general? So finding condition on this is not quite easy. We thought about it for a while. So we found actually two conditions. So I just presented one condition, and then so this condition is the complete monotonicity of f on Orbis. Okay. Okay, so I'm going to tell you why right now. So in the equality, so recall that f is completely monotone. So f of t plus s can be written in this way, okay, thanks to the assumption. And now I can plunge this this expression in the expression I just got in the lemma. Okay, so it disappeared. So remember that we know this term for any positive, thanks to this lemma, we know this term for any positive t. Okay, so I plunge this expression into this integral here, and what I get by using QE is this Laplace transform. That is the Laplace transform of a measure, of this measure. So I know, actually, since I know this term for any positive t, I know the Laplace transform of this measure, okay, for any positive t. And now, I know the Laplace transform of this positive measure on the positive real line, so which means that I know its density, I know the density of this measure on the support, but only on the support of the measure. So this density is continuous. So I know, I know the density, this continuous density of the support of mu. And now I need to, this density is itself a Laplace transform. Okay, so I need to know this Laplace transform on a set. So that's actually a result, a general result, which is from Feller, which can be found in Feller. So if we know the Laplace transform of a measure on a set an, well, sequence an such that an minus 1 is infinity, then well, it's in us to characterize a measure. Okay. So since the support of this measure contains such a sequence, we know the Laplace transform we know actually the Laplace transform, this Laplace transform on this sequence, so which means that we know the function f bar almost sure for the Lebesgue measure, okay, which is enough to characterize the measure mu, okay, the step distribution of the Ron Doney, right? Okay, so that's for the completely monotone case. And now there is the analytic case. Okay, so that using similar ideas, we can also prove this result. Okay, so we now have again we assume that mu is absolutely continuous in R, and then now instead of assuming that its density in R plus is completely monotone, we assume that there is a complex value function k, say, such that f of t can be expressed in this way. So that's very general, actually. We can take and k has to satisfy this moment condition. So the moment of the measure k of u du have to be actually to not to grow too fast. Actually, so they should not grow too fast, which explains this. And also k should not vanish on intervals on sub-intervals intervals of R, which is also quite important. Right. So these two conditions actually imply that f is analytic, well, on R plus, and also it admits an analytic continuation, obviously, in the whole real line, because we can take t here to be R, and then f will be analytic on the whole. Then, okay, in this situation, then again, the measure mu can be characterized only by the data of f itself on the positive line and f star f on the positive line. So that's also satisfied in this case. Okay, so I will not present the proof of this fact, which is a little bit longer than the proof for the
completely monotonic case. At least the beginning of the idea is the same, so we just want to write f does of the Laplace transform or the characteristic function of some complex valued function. Obviously here, k is complex value, but its characteristic function is real and positive. It happens. Right, so let me give examples when this happens, for instance. So that's very easy, actually. You can take any function k, which is symmetric, for instance, on the real line, and which satisfies these two conditions. So that there is many examples that you can construct. And here, for instance, we consider this very famous example, when k of u is the Laplace, what we call the Laplace distribution, or the density of the Laplace distribution, anyway, and then its Fourier transform is the density of the up to a constant of the Cauchy distribution. Then, according to the Brevius theorem, it means that this function, actually, if you recognize, because you know the measure nu in R plus, then you know its density in R plus. If you recognize such a function, then you see, you say, okay, I only need to know f and f star f on R plus in order to know what this measure is. And moreover, okay, so this distribution belongs to the analytic class. So, and moreover, it does not belong to any of the exponential class and the monotone class. Okay, so first, it does not belong to the first class, the exponential class that I presented in the beginning of this talk, because it's clear that this distribution has no positive exponential moments. And also, it's clear that this function is not completely monotone. So I think the second derivative changes time. It's easy to see. Okay, so, just in order to justify that those classes are quite different from each other, actually. And then, what about the completely monotone function? Well, about the completely monotone class, so I just define this function, which is completely monotone because that the Laplace transform on R plus of a measure, some measure on R plus, okay, which satisfies this condition on the sequence and this support, because the support in this case is R plus. Then this function, is completely monotone, so it belongs to the measure, the associative measure, okay, belongs to the completely monotone class. But also, it's easy to check that it has no positive exponential moments, so it does not, again, it does not belong to the exponential class, and it does not belong to the analytic class, actually, because this function, remember I said that completely monotone functions are analytic on the open positive half lines, and which is the case here, but actually it cannot be analytic on the whole real line because it explodes at zero. It explodes at zero, so it cannot have an analytic continuation of the whole positive real line. So it does not belong to the analytic class. Again, those two classes are so now let me talk about the infinitely divisible case. So that's how all this story started with Vincent Vigon's thesis in 2001, actually, where he considered new and infinitely divisible distribution, so the law of a Levy process at time 1, and you know that can be expressed according to the so-called Levy formula. And in this case, the Wiener-Hopf factorization writes in this way. So S plus psi of t can be written as the product of the characteristic exponent of the of both the ladder processes, okay, bivariate ladder processes of the Levy process. So, but actually, the bivariate ladder process or the Levy process, well, will be actually the counterpart of tau s tau plus. So that for Levy process xt, then what I call tau x tau plus is completely, well, it's defined at actually in the case when there is a non-trivial local time at the maximum of the Levy process. So this bivariate upward ladder process is defined in a completely different way. Okay, so for instance here we've got a process in continuous time which is a subordinator. This bivariate process is a subordinator. This process is the right continuous inverse of the local time at the maximum of the Levy process, and we consider then the Levy process itself taken at this subordinator, which gives a bivariate subordinator here. So that's the continuous time counterpart of this variable. But now I consider the characteristic, the Laplace exponent of this bivariate subordinator. And in this case, okay, we can decompose psi in terms of the product of those two exponents. So there is a relationship between both Wiener-Hopf factorizations, and actually we can only when we have a compound constant process we can recover one from the other. But actually when the Levy process actually is regular in the positive half-life, when you have a right local time at the maximum, when this is a non-trivial subordinator, then Wiener-Hopf factorization, although they are quite similar, are completely different. We cannot find chi plus from kappa plus or chi minus from kappa minus. But in this case, still we have some results. So in this case, so again, this is the counterpart of the result I presented in the beginning of this talk for random walks. The knowledge of kappa plus, okay, of this Laplace exponent of the bivariate subordinator at the maximum of the ladder height process is equivalent to the knowledge of the measure, what I call measure, it's an abuse of notation, actually, measure mu star t, where mu star t is the law of xt. Okay? So the knowledge of this, that's not very deep result, actually, it's quite easy to see. But in particular, the knowledge of kappa plus implies the knowledge of chi plus. Because you can see, actually, you can also see, if you start from a Levy process, xt, right, then you can see, you can consider the problem that I stated at the beginning of this talk, where you want to characterize a measure mu of the Levy process at one, time one, for instance. And you know, what you know is not the Levy process, but only the random walk at discrete times, okay? 1 to k, for instance. So you know only this random walk, which is sk. Okay, so that's a different problem. But actually, if we know, well, kappa plus, then we know chi plus. That is, we know the upward Wiener-Hopf factor of x1. Okay, so which means that if we can solve the general problem for random walks, then we can solve the problem for Levy processes. Because knowing, okay, the law, if we know, if knowing the law of chi plus, we can determine what is the law of x1, what is mu, then obviously knowing kappa plus, we can determine it as well. Okay.
Then, using well, quite important results from Vigon's thesis on the relationship between the Levy measure of the Levy process itself and the Levy measure of the Lederheit process, we are able to find this new class of distributions where this conjecture in the particular case of infinitely distribution is satisfied. It is when the measure, well, the function pi of t plus infinity, which is a decreasing function, is completely monotone. And also I forget this condition that I presented, so it also has to satisfy this additional condition. Then, in this case, the measure is entirely determined by the Laplace exponent of the upward bivariate ladder process of the Levy process. Okay, so, and also, we can also add the condition, well, another condition on this Levy measure in order to, for this conjecture to be satisfied. This is when this Levy measure, well, this function actually can be written as the Fourier transform of complex function satisfying some moment conditions, so that mimic more or less both in the discrete case. Right, so that's all.